The beauty of life can be found in many ways. The joy of helping others. The joy of belonging to someone. The joy of being able to choose from endless opportunities. Well, for some, living like this is not a given. This is true to the millions of people living with psychiatric and neurological disorders. Because if your brain and mind is affected by diseases like depression, schizophrenia, Parkinson's disease, or Alzheimer's disease, more than ever, you will experience limitations in life. But what we also know is that it is possible to overcome the challenges and regain many of life's opportunities. For decades, our focus has been to unravel the secrets of the brain to develop better treatments. We have delivered some of the most important contributions and are continuing to advance the way psychiatric and neurological disorders are treated in the 21st century. We keep our focus and feel proud when we can help bring back joy in patients' lives. We will continue to make progress for patients. And we will do so because we are Lundbeck.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم فقال ربكم ادعوني استجب لكم آمين يا رب العالمين الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين اللهم اجمع شمل المسلمين والكريستيان والأمم في مدينة دباب وسلم دائما مجتمعنا هذا بالسلم والأمن والتقدم في بلدنا هذا آمين يا رب العالمين ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب ربنا إنك أنت الوهاب ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار وصلى الله على خير خلقه سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين آمين يا رب العالمين
In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you today to praise and worship you and give you thanks for all the things you continue to provide for ourselves and our families. Father, we humbly ask for forgiveness for all the times we have offended you. When we forget to acknowledge your presence in the image of our brothers and sisters, and for moments we fail to be good stewards of the blessings you have given us. Continue to guide and protect each one of us, Lord, that we may always walk in the light of your everlasting love and mercy. Grant us, Father, with your comfort in times of distress and with your strength in times of weakness. Bestow upon us your unending grace and healing, that we in turn become instruments of gentleness and compassion to others. We ask all this in the name of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, with the prayer and the intercession of our Blessed Mother. Amen.
Mga kababayan, ang pambansang awit ng Pilipinas.
Good day, everyone. The Southern Philippines Medical Center Institute of Psychiatry and Behavioral Medicine is glad to offer you today not one, but two timely talks discussing the pandemic and beyond in relation to the older age group. We hope that this postgraduate course will not only be meaningful, but also fun and enlightening. We know that there are many challenges of living with, caring for, and being in the geriatric population. And we encourage everyone not only to listen, but to actively participate and post any comments or questions you may have. So, through the leadership of our dynamic chair, Dr. Abigail Lozada Laganao, our CL psychiatrists, whom I'll be introducing briefly, and the efforts of our ever-energetic and enthusiastic residents, we are proud to officially welcome you to SPMC IPBM's first postgraduate course in geriatric psychiatry entitled Pandemic and Beyond, Reintegration During the Peri-Pandemic Period. Our first speaker is an alumni of the Davao Medical School Foundation. She underwent residency training in psychiatry at Southern Philippines Medical Center and finished her fellowship training in CL psychiatry at the Medical City in Pasig. She is the immediate past training officer of SPMC IPBM and is currently a member of the Board of Membership for the Philippine Psychiatric Association. She is an active consultant at Southern Philippines Medical Center and Davao Regional Medical Center, and is also affiliated with MDMRC, Davao Doctors, San Pedro, Brockenshire, and Adventist Hospital. To discuss moving forward through positive aging is Dr. Dova Sion Gonzalez.
Thank you, Dr. Ancheta, for the very generous introduction. And good morning, everyone. It is my pleasure to be with you this morning because we'll be talking about the topic that is very interesting. And at the end of this lecture, we'll be exploring the concepts of positive aging, as well as the ways to enhance the experience of aging positively. Like if you remember, like 2 years ago, we were really slowing down because of the pandemic. But thanks to the mass vaccination drive, we are slowly going back to our usual lives and routines, especially like we experience being stuck in a heavy traffic jam and we see students preparing for their face-to-face classes. And as we slowly reintegrate to our usual lives and routines, the reality is that our elderly population is still a vulnerable population for COVID-19 infection. However, life goes on as we add years to our existence each time we celebrate our birthdays. And that brings us to the idea of aging. How do we picture ourselves when we think about aging? When we think of aging, many of us will think of the frail and wrinkly versions of our younger selves. The traditional age that we know to define aging, such as 60 in Western countries, 60 in the Philippines and 65 in Western countries, this definition is based on history, which is the age of retirement and not by biology. Because biologically speaking, aging is a gradual, continuous process and a natural change that begins as soon as adulthood is reached. And it is much part of life, such as childhood, adolescence, and infancy. So upon adulthood, we experience a lot of changes that marks the start of aging. So as early as in our 20s, our senses of hearing, vision, and touch starts to decline. Like our skin will start to lose its collagen. Our lenses of the eye starts to be rigid and the sensitivity of our hearing starts to decline as early as in our 20s, but mostly it is noticeable when we are in our 50s. And for our senses of smell and taste, it starts to decline when we are in our 50s. So these changes will continue to progress and makes us vulnerable to develop age-related health conditions. However, with the advent of the technology, the lifespan is increasing, and the life expectancy for Philippines is 71.53%, which is a 0.18% increase from 2021. And as many researchers focus on the negative impacts of aging, like the decline of physical vitality and function, decreased social networks, limited employment opportunities and losses, studies also showed that in aging, there is stability in crystallized intelligence and wisdom. Some researchers and policymakers feel that enough time has been spent on the negative aspects of aging and that the balance should be addressed by analyzing positive aging with the aim of promoting well-being in the future generations. And that brings us to the idea of positive aging, which is also known as successful aging. So successful aging is the process of maintaining a positive attitude, feeling good about ourselves, keeping fit and healthy, and engaging life as we age. It also refers to a multidimensional involvement with life that is inclusive of the physical, functional, psychological, social, and spiritual health. And when we talk about spiritual health, it is a sense of connection to something bigger than ourselves, and it typically involves a search for meaning in life. Then why should we learn about positive aging? Positive aging is adopting a positive mindset that aging is a natural way of life. that all of us go through this journey and view this as a part of our adventure in moving forward. The practice of positive aging helps us cope better to the reality of the physical and mental declines that accompanies the aging process. And it also supports us as the discrimination erodes our sense of worth. So how do we practice positive aging? First is for us to strengthen our spirit. As we start to experience the physical and cognitive decline associated with aging, it is very important for us to recognize that we are more than just a physical being. We are called to connect to our spirit, not necessarily a soul for those who are non-believers of soul. The term spirituality can sometimes be narrowly construed as religious forms of spirituality, when in fact, it can take many non-religious forms that connects us as a person to our purpose, meaning, and values. In psychology, it is discovering our own inner awareness that something is greater within us, that we have an essence to our existence and it continues to grow, and it cannot be eroded by the physical and mental decline that is associated by aging. It is very important to connect to our spirit because that part of us is stable and extraordinary. By connecting and strengthening to that non-physical part of us, it will give us the clarity of understanding life, that we will be confident and secure to cope with life's changes that is accompanied in aging, that is present in the aging process. Another way to promote aging, positive aging, is to be mindful, to be present, to focus in the now. Are we currently bothered by the idea of getting older? Are we fixated to the memories of our younger selves so we can eat anything without bothering that our blood sugars will go high or we will gain weight? Or do we worry so much about the future that we fail to see our current abundance and opportunities? Then let's bring back ourselves to the present, that this is us now after 50, 60, 70 years of experiencing life. To spend our time worrying about the past and the future is to rob ourselves to truly living in the present. Aging can be an opportunity to have a simpler life, thus making it easier for us to be present. To enhance the experience of being truly present, we can try meditation. Meditation can be intimidating at first because true mindfulness requires a meditation of 30 minutes. But that is something very difficult for us to achieve for us beginners. So we can try a 2 to 5 minutes meditation in the morning and another set of 2 to 5 minutes in the evening. In meditation, our goal is to reconnect, recenter, recharge, and gain the strength necessary to take the steps that will create real change. Another way to reinforce our mindfulness is to simplify our day by avoiding multitasking. A simple life is coming and it allows us to focus in the present. And when our thoughts about the past brings misery to our present situation, then maybe we can practice blocking it off. It's okay for us to think about the past or the future if it brings us happiness. However, if it only brings us misery, then we have to learn to let it go. When we are in pain because of our arthritic knees, let's not linger in the past when we can still run a marathon, but rather focus on how we can master using the cane at the present. This holds true also if our thoughts about the future scares us. Let's practice blocking that thought. Then what about if the thought of the present is so scary? Then this is the time for us to go back to our past or think about the future if those thoughts were better than our present moment. Of course, we cannot miss the practice of positivity in the practice of positive aging. It is the practice of being positive or optimistic in attitude. So positive thinking actually means approaching life's challenges with a positive outlook. It does not necessarily mean avoiding or ignoring bad things. Instead, it involves making the most of the potentially bad situations, trying to see the best in other people, and viewing ourselves and our abilities in a positive light. By nature, 80% of our daily thoughts are negative thoughts, and practicing positivity can be quite challenging for us to practice, and that we have to make it a habit. The following are examples in expressing true positivity. It acknowledges the negative events that a person is experiencing and hopes that something better will come out despite the challenges. It does not invalidate the challenging or painful events that we are experiencing. We can also reinforce the habit of positivity by having affirmations. The theory behind some affirmations is that the more we say something, the more it imposes itself into our subconscious, where it begins to become a reality. In effect, we can reprogram our subconscious mind through daily repetitions and affirmations. And the following are examples that we can practice for ourselves. Another example to enhance positivity is to have that sense of gratitude. We can have a gratitude journal. Experiencing gratitude is the simplest way to boost that sense of positivity. Appreciating the aging process can help us feel good about ourselves. We can try by writing thank you for the opportunity to be alive, for the opportunity to witness our children as they become parents themselves. It is difficult to practice positivity during trying circumstances. However, we have to stick with it to notice the result. And a finding in an old Harvard study may help us with our practice with positivity. In this study, it stated that our lives continue to evolve in our later years and often become more fulfilling than before. And people who do well in old age did not necessarily do well in midlife. Also, we have to keep our sense of humor. We have to give something for ourselves and to others and make friends who are younger than us and learn new things and have fun. Another way to practice positivity is to practice the four A's, which include the acceptance, appreciation, attitude, and adaptation. For acceptance, it is one of the keys for stress-free aging. Let's accept our fate that we are aging and it is inevitable. It's something that we cannot escape. Aging is something that we all go through, that it has its own sets of inconveniences. And once we have accepted that reality, we will be more appreciative of our remaining time and we will enjoy the opportunity of this present moment. Next is that we have to learn how to adapt. One advantage of aging is our experiences through the years. Remember the first time when we went to school and we were so anxious about it, yet we ended doing well because we adapted. Let's adapt as we age. If reading is getting difficult because of age-related decline to vision, then it's time for us to start using our eyeglasses. When hearing is becoming more difficult, then let's try the hearing aid. And of course, the another A is the appreciation. Appreciation is practiced by being grateful. We are thankful of the simple pleasures that we experience. Like by being simply here to experience life despite the COVID-19 pandemic going on. And let's be appreciative of the cane that helps us when our knees are painful. Let's appreciate the hearing aid that helps us hear better. Let's appreciate of the time and experience that we are able to witness the growth of our children. And when we practice appreciation, it's easier for us to see things in a positive light. And of course, we have to observe attitude. We have to have the right attitude. It is a settled way of thinking or feeling about someone or something that typically one is reflected in a person's behavior. This is a challenge for us to be not stuck in a forever young attitude. Aging is not a life sentence, and that can be a source of pride that we have lived this long and we are able to have our own set of experiences. And when we start experiencing the physical and cognitive decline associated with aging, let's not lose sight that with aging, we have that experience which we don't have when we were younger. Let's have the attitude to age gracefully and confidently as we age. As what Dr. Laria shares in his book, a society perceives that senior citizens are over the hill, which suggests that they are on the side of the hill. But in reality, seniors have lived a life full of experiences, lessons, and learned skills. They have made it to the top of the hill and have earned the right to stay on top in their golden years. So why go down to the hill? It took so long for them to be on the top, so they have to stay and enjoy the scenery. And this is an attitude shift that benefits every senior citizen. Next approach is to strengthen our social networks. It is necessary for our well-being to establish social supports that matters to us. It comes from both giving and receiving social support. So, how? Let's maintain close connection with friends. When was the last time we called them? And how can we meet new friends? Let's join activities, be it in church or local organizations. And of course, it is very important to maintain a close and loving relationship with family. The power of us starts from home. With every generation, family members grow old, and how they are honored and cared for shapes the attitudes of the next generation of children. Let's show our children how family and friends make a positive difference in an older person's life. Lastly, for us to age positively is to find a balance. In the process of aging, we may find ourselves out of balance as we experience the physical and cognitive decline. For us to find the equilibrium, we have to constantly address our needs and adapt to the challenges of aging. We need to have a deeper understanding of our strengths and weaknesses, and to put greater emphasis on our strengths to help repair our weaknesses. And how can we enhance our sense of balance? First, we have to reassess our expectations. Is our current mindset the same when we were in our 20s? Are we expecting to run a 30-kilometer marathon with our arthritic knees? The objective when we were aging is not to change and manage expectations, but to be free ourselves from expectations, or to keep them low at rational levels. By reassessing our expectations, we give room to ourselves to be pleasantly surprised. Expectations are future-based and assume a certain result. Possibilities reflect our preferences for the future. Realizing that the future is unknown and open to infinite number of prospects. Since we have no preconceived notions or expectations of what will occur in the future, we are better able to respond to events affecting our lives. Like for instance, we tripped while we were jogging and we sustained a fracture, and the doctor advised us to not jog anymore. If we have zero expectations, it's easier for us to follow the doctor's advice or not jogging, and that our frustrations will be kept to a minimum. And the list of possibilities that we can do will include swimming and walking in the future. Another way to enhance that sense of balance is to strengthen our methods to deal with stressful situations, which is our coping skills. For us to cope, we need to manage our stress, exhibit positivity under trying circumstances, exhibit patience, and find humor in very challenging situations. Another way is to look into our lifestyle. By looking into our lifestyle, we are keeping our balance in check. Are we still binging the chicharon that we crave when we were younger? Is it hard for us to break the habit of drinking Coke despite our blood sugar that is very, very high? We have to monitor our lifestyle and make adjustments that better align with our aging life. Like, we have to have regular checkups, take advantage of health screenings, and engage in healthy preventive behaviors. Lastly, we have to look at our priorities. What are our priorities at this point in life? Reprioritizing our lives is essential for successful aging. If our priorities are not aligned correctly with our new life experiences, chances are we will end up feeling unsatisfied and disappointed with our lives. Then what is our vision? How would we like to spend the rest of our lives? What are our activities that does not support our vision? What are we spending most of our time doing? If it's not top priority item, then why are we spending time with it? Identifying how we spend with our time helps us reprioritize our changing lives. We will be able to better allocate our time and energy to the things that matters and avoid spending time on things that no longer matters. In summary, aging is something that we all go through and that we can age successfully by practicing positive aging. So, we have to look at the positive, the things that can reinforce the experience of positive aging, like connecting to our spirit, practicing mindfulness to be here and to be present in the now. We also have to practice genuine positivity, not toxic positivity. Observe the four A's, like acceptance. We have to learn to adapt, appreciate, and check our attitude. Let's continue to expand our network of support and maintain our balance and check our priorities. And that, I'd like us to end with Ashton Appleton's words. I mean, Ashton Applewhite's words, that aging is not a problem or disease. Aging is living. Thank you for your kind attention.
Our second speaker for today earned her degree in medicine at the West Visayas State University. We are proud to say that she is also an alumni of the Psychiatry Residency Training Program here at the Southern Philippines Medical Center, Institute of Psychiatry and Behavioral Medicine. After her residency training, she underwent fellowship training in consultation liaison psychiatry at the Medical City in Pasig. Currently, she is not only an active consultant at SBMC, Institute of Psychiatry and Behavioral Medicine, but is also our research coordinator. To talk about From Reaction to Reintegration, the strengths and challenges of geriatric population during COVID-19 and the new normal is Dr. Isa Katrina Francisco Masakupan.
Good day, everyone. Today, we will be looking back to the challenges of the elderly populations during the heights of COVID-19 pandemic and the new normal, but at the same time, learn from their strengths and how they are effectively coping in this very challenging period. It became evident early in the coronavirus pandemic that older age is a risk factor for becoming severely ill with COVID-19, and their odds of survival are the lowest due to weakened immune system, physical inactivity, and stress. Comorbidities, which are very common in this age group, such as hypertension, diabetes, and pulmonary and cardiac diseases are the main underlying etiologies collectively in 32 to 60% of severe COVID cases. While the median age of confirmed COVID-19 cases in 2020 is 51 years old, fatality rates for those over 80 years of age is 5 times the global average. But the virus impact on older adults goes beyond a higher risk for serious infection. It also includes limited access to care for all health conditions, as well as considerable psychological, social, and economic hardships. Due to their vulnerability, older people have been subject to stricter isolation measures than other population groups. Stay-at-home restrictions and strict physical distancing have targeted older adults earlier, for longer, and more aggressively compared to younger age groups. For example, public health authorities banned older adults to enter supermarkets and grocery shops and introduced senior early shopping hours in pharmacies and other essential services. Although measures like social distancing and quarantines remain the most effective tactics for shielding the most vulnerable during this outbreak, age-based measures fail to take into account the negative impact that long periods of isolation will have on older people's physical, mental, and cognitive well-being. Social connectedness and engagement with other people are important to promote successful aging. However, this being directly challenged by physical distancing policies. The researchers found that even before the coronavirus, about a quarter of older adults fit the definition of socially isolated, which measures routine social contact. Conversely, researchers have found that robust social networks and interactions improve health for older adults. That's creating a difficult situation for older people who need protection from diseases like COVID-19 but may already be quite isolated. In a national poll done last June 2020 in the United States, more than half of older adults, 56%, reported feeling isolated from others compared to 27% in 2018. The results of this poll suggest that the COVID-19 pandemic has had a substantial impact on feelings of loneliness, including lack of companionship and isolation, and social connections among older adults during the early months of the pandemic than in 2018, when those numbers were already worrisomely high. Chronic loneliness can adversely affect memory, mental and physical health, and longevity. So the concern here isn't just older people who may get sick. It's people who will experience a drop in their quality of life in response to the outbreak. It is also important to recall that the initial quarantine period in the Philippines overlapped with the Roman Catholic Lenten season, an extremely important holiday for Filipinos. Older Filipinos were unable to attend church services and observe traditional Holy Week religious practices, thereby increasing their sense of isolation. For many older Filipinos, going to the church every Sunday, followed by family gatherings, is a tradition that they look forward to, but is now not possible. And this has added to a sense of sadness and yearning. Older Filipinos have also lost connection with their spiritual leaders, church peers, and volunteer work, which may exacerbate feelings of uncertainty. The disruption of important day-to-day activities for older individuals can pose negative impact on elderly's cognitive impairment, leading to poor mental health, and may be vulnerable to develop symptoms of anxiety and depression. A study found that social isolation increased the level of anxiety with depressive symptoms in elderly individuals and that depression symptoms were more common in the elderly who felt lonely and lacked social support. In addition, factors such as uncertainties during the pandemic, the risk of virus transmission to oneself and family members, and the lack of drugs to treat the virus further increase anxiety levels of the elderly. Overall, during the early phase of pandemic, specifically the community quarantine poses symptoms associated with late life anxiety and depression. However, it is important to note, and it was indicated on several researches, that compared to younger population, surprisingly results show that younger age was a risk factor for worsened components of anxiety and depression compared to older ones. Another identified health risk with being at home is a decline in physical activity, which has a negative impact on older individuals. Staying at home leads to a more sedentary lifestyle, such as sitting a lot or spending more time watching TV, and engaging in unhealthy behavior such as overeating, staying up late, and not getting adequate sleep, or even increasing tobacco and alcohol use. Reduced physical activity and unhealthy behaviors are linked to increased morbidity and mortality in older individuals. Patients with COVID-19 who are hospitalized are completely isolated in the ward and separated from their loved ones, as no visitors are allowed in the hospital. Older Filipinos in the hospital with little capability of using digital technology have a difficult time adjusting to the isolation and minimal contact with their families. When they clinically deteriorate, it becomes extremely difficult to be alone. And particularly in the worst outcomes, when a patient dies alone in the hospital. This is extremely difficult to cope with, as nobody should die alone, and families who are unable to see their loved ones before they die are at risk of complicated bereavement. Another aggravating factor for families left behind is the restriction on wakes and burials, which are traditionally week-long events filled with religious and ceremonial activities in the Philippines, often leading to lack of closure over the death of their loved ones. The pandemic has had another devastating impact on this population, one that is less visible, frequently ignored, and often a source of stigma: elder abuse. A study in the American Journal of Geriatric Psychiatry suggests that 1 in 5 older people has experienced elder abuse during the pandemic, a jump of nearly 84% over pre-pandemic estimates. Group of researchers from Yale School of Public Health and Yale University conducted a survey of 897 people in the USA aged 60 years and older via 2 online platforms from April 23 through May 5, 2020. The researchers created a 10-item elder abuse assessment and asked participants if they experienced any of 10 possible incidents of elder abuse since the beginning of the pandemic. The incidents included whether someone close to them tried to hurt or harm them, no one wanted them around, whether they were afraid of someone in the family, whether someone had taken their money or belongings without their consent, and other indicators of abuse. Roughly 21% of the participants answered yes to at least one question during the assessment, compared with 11.6% reporting past year abuse. Moreover, 5.4% of participants reported that someone tried to hurt or harm them during the pandemic, compared with 1.6% in the past. The prevalence of financial abuse rose as well. 7.5% reported that someone had taken their money or belongings without their consent. Recognizing all older adults as an at-risk category, the current pandemic has the potential to change the social representation of old age and reinforce ageism-based beliefs and attitudes among the population, including the elderly themselves. Ageism is defined as stereotypes, prejudice or discrimination against, but also in favor of people because of their chronological age. Examples for ageist discourse and actions during the pandemic are manifold. Boomer remover, the old ones spoiled the statistics, stay home, save grandma. These are just some of the phrases that have been used in public discourse when it comes to the description of the COVID-19 with relation to older adults. Numerous commentaries have observed a considerable increase in ageism during the pandemic, ranging from outright discrimination such as the decision not to provide life-saving treatment on the basis of chronological age to more subtle, well-meant, but also impactful forms of patronizing such as strongly advising older people to self-isolate indefinitely regardless of health status. In a study by Falbo in 2021 entitled Live Experiences of Older Adults During the COVID-19 Lockdown, a Qualitative Study, one of the major findings reveals the traumatic consequences generated by labeling all older adults under one single at-risk category, neglecting inter-individual differences and diversity that exist through the life course and persist in late life, irrespective of chronological age. For most of study's participants, being associated with the fragile was inconceivable, especially since older age today is no longer a synonymous of frailty, but is often associated with an active social life, self-development, and fulfillment. Being categorized and labeled as the vulnerable was recognized by the participants as a source of victimization, discrimination, and exclusion. The instances of ageism which emerged during the crisis might have severe consequences above and beyond the current pandemic. Besides the long-standing evidence for the detrimental influence of ageism on the individual and society, perceived ageism during the pandemic is linked to increased anxiety and lower well-being and subjective health of older adults. While the changes and restrictions in daily life are noticeable and immense in many cases, digital tools and resources have been highlighted as possible means of mitigating the worst of the negative consequences. The use of technology to continue to stay in touch with family, friends, and loved ones has become an important way to combat these negative effects associated with prolonged loneliness and isolation. Virtual socializing and online events have become commonplace and have gone a long way to keeping people from being completely isolated while in lockdown. Online education has also become the new normal in many places as schools and universities turn to online classes to keep students' education on track. Healthcare has also turned to digital solutions, and making both mental and physical healthcare available online has become more common and has been fairly successful in helping mitigate the negative effects of reduced healthcare access. This shift into the digital realm extends beyond just the healthcare sector. Online access to COVID-19 related news, grocery delivery services, group socialization, and many more services have become commonplace. However, one group likely to benefit the least from the digital alternatives are the elderly population, who have significantly lower rates of internet usage and acceptance than other age groups. This results in a worrying paradox. The population most negatively affected by the COVID-19 pandemic are also the least likely to be able to access the resources put in place to mitigate the effects. This paradox can largely be attributed to the poor digital literacy skills found amongst the elderly population compared to younger groups, most commonly described as the digital divide. Research has pointed out that gray digital divide is linked to poor healthcare in the present age. Many healthcare services, as mentioned, can be availed over the internet, including appointment booking, secured communication with a medical practitioner, paying bills, and the list goes on. However, people on the wrong side of digital divide, especially elderly, will continue to suffer from effective healthcare in the near future. This is because electronic healthcare will dominate in the not too distant future, but simultaneously aging will also increase. Even though the pandemic put the older population at greater risk compared to any age group, research has still showed that older people report better emotional experience than younger people. Several studies published over the last year have underlined this concept. Specifically, they were more likely to report feelings of calm, interest, and appreciation. The most striking difference was that older people reported experiencing negative emotions substantially less often than younger people. These findings hold when the society considered their perceived risk and other variables such as personality and employment status. So what makes older people more resilient to stress than younger populations? Two factors likely account for these age advantages. The first is experience. Older people have had more years to encounter stressful and negative experiences, and they've had more time to learn how to cope with these experiences, as well as what works for them and what doesn't in times of stress. Another important factor is that older people experience changes in their motivations and goals. There is considerable evidence that older people are more motivated to focus on the good in their daily lives and accept rather than dwell on what's bad. Instead of focusing on and worrying about the future, older adults tend to prioritize goals about the here and now. Furthermore, a study of Fuller in 2020 highlighted the resilience nature of older adults in terms of their psychological coping and adaptability during the COVID-19 crisis. Consistent with theoretical perspective on coping in later life, their findings suggest that the majority of older adults perceive themselves to be coping well in the initial weeks of the pandemic. This study's finding that most older adults perceive themselves as coping well is also consistent with prior empirical research demonstrating high rates of proactive coping and adaptive coping strategies among older adults. The three types of coping that emerge, staying busy, seeking social support, and having a positive mindset, are each consistent with proactive coping strategies intended to minimize the negative impact of the social distancing stressor. Staying busy and maintaining a daily routine were proactive strategies older adults used to keep themselves occupied and healthy, both physically and mentally. This coping strategy may be consistent with using distracting behaviors to redirect thoughts, which has been found to be an effective coping mechanism in the initial phases of disasters. However, beyond distraction, older individuals also describe staying busy as helping them to feel their life had meaning and purpose despite needing to stay isolated at home. This further suggested that older adults maintain their sense of well-being and identity by being able to maintain their daily patterns of living. Their desire for continuity was evident, and developing a somewhat normative activity pattern was quite adapted in the circumstances. Similar to findings from the SARS epidemic, seeking social support was a key coping strategy used by the geriatric population. In the initial weeks of social distancing, older adults adjusted well by increasing communication with their support partners. Seeking social support during the COVID-19 pandemic seemed characteristic of resilience among these older adults. Moreover, this theme highlights the protective role of social networks during stressful times in accordance with the convoy model, which suggests people benefit from greater social support during major life events. Though it is frequently thought that older adults cannot adapt to new technology, it was noted in most literature that most adults were willing and even open to the idea about using technology to foster social connection. The final coping theme that was identified was having a positive mindset, indicated the prominence of emotion-focused coping within the older research participants. Consistent with prior research on SARS, these older adults were more likely to engage in emotion-focused coping than problem-focused coping, which is adaptive in a widespread pandemic that an individual cannot readily assume. Positive coping was common among participants ranging from acceptance of the situation to optimism about the future. Moreover, this theme is in accordance with social-emotional selectivity theory. In the case of COVID-19 pandemic, many older adults appear to prioritize positive emotions and thought processes even more explicitly as they acknowledge their greater mortality risk due to the virus. Similar to research following Hurricane Katrina in the U.S., older adults appear to actively shift their thought processes and perspectives to foster more positive emotions. Moreover, within this theme, the salience of faith to facilitate coping was predominant, consistent with other research finding that religious coping is often effective in large-scale crises. These high positive perceived ratings of coping may be indicative of enhanced emotional regulation in that older adults appear to successfully protect against experiencing emotional distress related to COVID-19. For instance, despite acknowledging social distancing as less than ideal, older individuals most frequently indicated they were coping well with this distressing situation, suggesting an ability to be emotionally resilient despite the occurrences. So, what younger people can learn regarding stress and well-being from older populations? We have to remember that time becomes more and more precious as we age. The older we get, the less time we have left, and it may be beneficial to focus our time, energy and motivation on what's meaningful and less time dwelling on the things that we have no control. It's important to note that this type of shift isn't a denial or avoidance of the negative aspects. It's more about not becoming overwhelmed by the negative and focusing more attention and energy on what brings joy and pleasure. As the peri-pandemic period continues, how can older people best be supported? It is evident that older people care more than any other age group about emotionally meaningful aspects of life. In the midst of this pandemic, we expect that for older people, being unable to hug their grandchildren, spend time with treasured friends, and engage in meaningful activities is more detrimental to well-being than anxiety and fear of contracting COVID. The solution for older adults is to get back to engaging with life in whatever ways possible. This might mean connecting with friends and family, even virtually, and spending time on activities that bring meaning. Keep the elders involved, such as giving homebound older adults a project they can work on, and family members may need to assist the elderly as some of them may have difficulty with the complexities of modern technology. The interventions can include telephone calls with loved ones, friends, and voluntary organizations. In addition, the social digital leisure is also one way for older adults to combat isolation by creating a sense of community. Agencies or support groups can create volunteerism among older adults. As an example, older adults can utilize mobile phone calls for emotional support to those individuals who are in the most volatile households Or they can also conduct leisure classes through online platforms so that the potential elderly volunteer can make use of their lifelong skills. And lastly, they need to continue exercising through a home-based physical program. Evidence exists that regular physical activity and higher cardiovascular fitness among the elderly can show better responsiveness to vaccines, but investigation remains to be seen for COVID-19. People tend to view older people as frail and helpless, but remember that older adults have a reservoir of knowledge and skills that have helped them cope with the challenges that they face over many decades. Sometimes, people view older adults as weaker rather than the survivors who know how to thrive. As we move in the peri-pandemic period, we would develop age-friendly communities where older adults have the opportunity to share their experiences with younger generations without the stigma and stereotypes. This is an opportunity to recognize their age as an asset and a source of strength. In past years of living uncertainty, many older individuals stand at the ready, wanting to help and waiting to be asked. A resilient resource, waiting in a time of need. Thank you for your kind attention.
The beauty of life can be found in many ways. The joy of helping others. The joy of belonging to someone. The joy of being able to choose from endless opportunities. Well, for some, living like this is not a given. This is true to the millions of people living with psychiatric and neurological disorders. Because if your brain and mind is affected by diseases like depression, schizophrenia, Parkinson's disease, or Alzheimer's disease, more than ever, you will experience limitations in life. But what we also know is that it is possible to overcome the challenges and regain many of life's opportunities. For decades, our focus has been to unravel the secrets of the brain to develop better treatments. We have delivered some of the most important contributions and are continuing to advance the way psychiatric and neurological disorders are treated in the 21st century. We keep our focus and feel proud when we can help bring back joy in patients' lives. We will continue to make progress for patients. And we will do so because we are Lundbeck.
Thank you, Dr. Yambao. In behalf of the Southern Philippines Medical Center Institute of Psychiatry and Behavioral Medicine, I award these certificates of appreciation to our speakers in our postgraduate course in geriatric psychiatry entitled Pandemic and Beyond: Reintegration During the Peri-Pandemic Period. This certificate is given to Dr. Dova M. Sion Gonzalez, signed by the Chair of the Committee, Dr. Joya Fe Ancheta as Training Officer, and yours truly as Department Chair of SPMC-IPBM. The same certificate is awarded to Dr. Isa Catrina Francisco Masakupan with the same signatories. Thank you very much, doctors. Good day again. Here in SPMC-IPBM, it is our aim to deliver service to the people of Mindanao through psychiatric consultations, disaster response, and mental health education. Since 2020, we have been through significant challenges because of this pandemic. Now, on our third year, we are faced with issues of reintegration. Thus, this postgraduate course was developed by our consultation liaison psychiatrists, Drs. Dova Sion Gonzalez and Dr. Isa Francisco Masakupan, which targeted one of the most important populations affected by the pandemic, the elderly. I would like to express my gratitude and my congratulations to them and the residents for making this PGC a success. I would also like to thank everyone here who attended for giving us an opportunity to talk about these timely and relevant topics this Saturday morning. Thank you very much and good morning.
Thank you.
The beauty of life can be found in many ways. The joy of helping others. The joy of belonging to someone. The joy of being able to choose from endless opportunities. Well, for some, living like this is not a given. This is true to the millions of people living with psychiatric and neurological disorders. Because if your brain and mind is affected by diseases like depression, schizophrenia, Parkinson's disease, or Alzheimer's disease, more than ever, you will experience limitations in life. But what we also know is that it is possible to overcome the challenges and regain many of life's opportunities. For decades, our focus has been to unravel the secrets of the brain to develop better treatments. We have delivered some of the most important contributions and are continuing to advance the way psychiatric and neurological disorders are treated in the 21st century. We keep our focus and feel proud when we can help bring back joy in patients' lives. We will continue to make progress for patients. And we will do so because we are Lundbeck. The beauty of life can be found in many ways. The joy of helping others. The joy of belonging to someone. The joy of being able to choose from endless opportunities. Well, for some, living like this is not a given. This is true to the millions of people living with psychiatric and neurological disorders. Because if your brain and mind is affected by diseases like depression, schizophrenia, Parkinson's disease, or Alzheimer's disease, more than ever, you will experience limitations in life. But what we also know is that it is possible to overcome the challenges and regain many of life's opportunities. For decades, our focus has been to unravel the secrets of the brain to develop better treatments. We have delivered some of the most important contributions and are continuing to advance the way psychiatric and neurological disorders are treated in the 21st century. We keep our focus and feel proud when we can help bring back joy in patients' lives. We will continue to make progress for patients. And we will do so because we are Lundbeck.